Donc, les cas, c'est ça.
Hello.
Les cas, c'est ça.
Ah, start yes, sir.
OK. Actually, we discussed about this server type models, right? Server model, rack servers, and blade servers. OK.
Yes.
So, what you need to concentrate on more on blade servers rather than tower servers and rack servers. Okay.
Yeah.
Then what else we discussed yesterday?
Types of
Motherboard.
hardware components. Components.
Yeah. Motherboards, we understood like how many sockets, what we need to identify on motherboard. The number of sockets availability. Once the socket is availability, then next component we need to identify is what memory modules are available, how many memory modules are available. Based on
Yes.
that, it is going to get an idea how much memory, how much CPU it can support,
Yes.
right?
Yes.
So the processor also we identified.
Yeah.
Under the processor, what components are important under processor? Like core, what is socket first of all? Socket is nothing but on the motherboard which is available.
Yes.
The next component is core. What is a core? What it is a socket? These are the basic things you should remember forever. Okay? Socket, core. Core means cores per chip. How many cores are available? Then the next important component is hyper-threading. What is hyper-threading? The hyper-threading is a feature enabled on the processor chip. At the same time, to get that benefit, we need to configure that configuration on the motherboard side also. How to configure on the motherboard? We have to go to the BIOS. Okay, there under processor setting, you will find hyper-threading enable disable option.
So
It is
is it same for servers and as well as for the
hyper-threading the processor performance only. The desktop processor, the hyper-threading concept is not available. Maybe in some processor companies, maybe need to check at the respective vendor site.
also?
Generally, the desktop operating system, the processors are not capable for hyper-threading. Hyper-threading is a feature to gives a maximum performance because whereas in desktop systems it is going to support only one user, whereas in server operating systems, server hardware supports multiple users, number of users. That's the reason hyper-threading is a feature. It gives the maximum performance. Okay, so three components under processor: socket, core, and hyper-threading. Okay, there you need to understand to how many physical CPUs are available, how many logical processors are available. Physical processors, in the sense, the chips which are available on the motherboard. If the socket is a two, if you install two processors, we call it as a two physical CPUs are available for this system. How many logical cores? According to the modem number, it is going to decide. We need to go to the respective vendor site and identify how many cores it can support. Even if you go to BIOS also, you can identify what is a processor configuration. Memory modules we discussed, okay?
Yes.
No, the concept is storage. We decided that we understood that there are five major important components in a hardware we need to identify to proceed with the server administration. What is the five components? One is a motherboard where we connect all components together. Okay. The second component is processor. We understood that concept, what we need to understand, what is the requirement for our administration. Okay. The next component is memory, RAM. The fourth one is storage. Okay. Storage, what is importance of storage? Okay. Importance of storage in the sense to load an operating system, to write any data, we need a space to store that information. Okay. That we call it as storage. Generally, we should not get any confusion that generally in considering mobile device, they will say that 32 GB memory. Okay, how much memory if you have and means they will say that 32 GB memory. We call it as a memory and RAM in one way, storage in another direction. Okay. As a technical person, we need to describe the configuration of this device. What is exact memory? What is the storage? As a technical person, we have to say that 2 GB RAM and 32 GB storage. Okay? For the mobile devices. The same way, coming to the systems, the servers, we are no more going to discuss about the desktop. Okay? Whatever the components we are going to discuss about, we are going to talk about the server components only. Okay? So, under this server component, what is the storage? The storage types, different types are available. The basic classification. One second, Srini. Okay, I'm coming back. Okay, are you there?
Yeah. Hello.
It's showing as past.
How come?
Okay. I resume the session.
Okay.
So here the storage comes coming to storage, there are majorly three components. Direct task storage. Okay. The next one is network. The next one is storage area network. Yeah, sorry to the disturbance.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. The storage, coming to the storage, there are three components majorly classified, like how we are going to use the storage. Direct attached storage. Generally, whatever the hard disk we are going to use, how we are connecting that hard disk to the system, that comes under direct attached storage. Generally, in a system, we connect what type of controllers we are going to use to access the server. If you are going to check normal system, there is an IDE controller, right?
Yes.
What else devices are available? One is IDE controller. Generally, in desktop systems, we can see IDE controller to connect hard disk. Okay, the next one is generally the high performance. If you come to server storage, the server hard disk are going to connect with the SCSI. Okay, some devices may connect with SATA. Okay. There are different type of technologies which connect the storage. Whatever the hard disk we are going to use, it is going to connect the system in a different manner by using different controllers. So based on that controllers, we need to identify what is the hard disk capacity. Hard disk capacity, how we need to measure here, it is not size. One parameter is size. Next one is IO, input and output, read and write, latency. What is all this component? In a server administration, we need to understand why we are going for server. The server is nothing but it is accessing by multiple users. So multiple users accessing the system, in the sense we provided high configuration of motherboard, high power of CPU, high capacity of memory. At the same time, if you use the less capacity, less speed of hard disk, why I call it as a less speed? The transfer rate, the data transfer rate, how it is going to transfer the data, how much speed it is going to write the data, how much speed it is going to read the data, that matters the server performance. The CPU is high configuration, memory is high configuration. If the hard disk, the storage is not responding for your data to write and read, access, there is no use of the high configuration of the server. So how it is going to decide what matters? If you consider mobile devices, have we ever noticed the class of the SD card?
Yes.
What is that classification?
Some class 3, class 4, some class 1.
Exactly. That what is that classes defines? The classes defines it is a number of read and write per second.
Yes.
If it is a normal class or class 2 or class 3, whatever it may be, maybe class A is the highest time, I think so.
Okay.
Okay. So what it is read access is in the sense for one SD card, it is going to access the speed of data 20 MB per second. Some SD card supports 300 MB per second. That in the sense, if you are going to record the video, HD radio video, we should go for high class. It supports high bandwidth. The data transfer rate should be 300 MB per second so that it can write the data with that speed. Okay. If you are going to use normal capacity of SD card, the performance of the accessing the data, it is going to take more time. Okay. So coming back to the server storage, what matters, what parameters we need to consider while choosing in a hard disk? Okay. Read and write access. Okay. How much data it can send, read and write at given second. That parameter we need to consider. Okay. So according to that, there are different storage hard disks available. Most of the storage hard disks are connected by using SCSI controller. Okay. You can mention what is a spindle, what is a read and write for a given second, what is a data transfer rate for a given second. Okay. So out of these controllers, one controller may support maximum throughput. Maximum throughput in the sense, maximum read and write per a given second. Okay. So here we call it as a hard disk. Okay. There are some storage components, latest motherboards, latest servers supports even SD cards as well. Flash disk. Nowadays, that says that flash disk. Flash disk in the sense the transfer rate is comparatively very high compared to the normal traditional hard disk. Okay, SD card. There are different storage media, how the storage server is going to come up with. Okay, so once you understand this direct attached storage, in-bus direct attached storage, what type of controllers are available, okay, which control I need to choose for the server. Okay, once that is decided, generally whenever you select a server, definitely the concept comes in RAID controller. What is that? Why we need RAID controller? Here, before going for RAID controller, we need to understand two basic concepts. Redundancy. High availability. What is redundancy? What is high availability? Okay. Before going for RAID controller, we should understand two concepts in a server administration. What is redundancy? What is high availability? High availability is a feature we consider application layer. If one application is there, we need to make sure that application is available even for some failures. Okay, so then we are going to use as a cluster software configuration, load balancing, and if one particular server is down, their services are going to run on another server. That is high availability. Okay, we'll discuss later this high availability. Coming to redundancy, what is the redundancy? I'm using one device, particular device. For example, to consider a hard disk. I have a one hard disk. I'm loading the server component. My server is running, one application server. maybe database server or any kind of application server is running. So I selected in a hardware server. I completed the operating system installation, server operating system installation. Once server operating system installed, then we are going to install an application. Okay. Something happens at the hard disk. What will happen, my data? What will happen, my application which we installed?
Yeah.
If hard disk is failed, means we are not going to in a position to retrieve the data. So there the concept comes in redundancy. If one hard disk is going to fail, how to retrieve the, how to save the data? Okay. The RAID controller concept comes in. Whatever the disk, hard disk we attach directly attached to the server, we need to configure that server hard disk with the configure RAID controller, RAID concept. Okay. RAID concepts, under RAID controller, you may come across RAID 0, RAID 1. There are RAID different parameters. Generally, we use these three components. What are those? RAID 0, RAID 1, RAID 5. Okay. What is RAID 0? We call it as mirror. Generally, whenever we configure RAID servers on a particular server, basically the server comes with two hard disks by default. Okay. How it is connected at the background, there will be a controller, RAID controller. It is a hardware device which can is going to support whatever the hard disk we are going to connect to that server. That RAID controller is going to configure those hard disk in a RAID configuration. What is this RAID configuration? If I have two hard disk, say 100 GB each, so two hard disk, once I configure mirror by enabling RAID 0 concept, what it is going to do? It is going to create a, by using two physical hard disk, each 100 GB, it is going to total, what is the size actually, what is the total size? It is total storage capacity is available on the server, 200 GB. Okay. If I go with the RAID 0 concept, okay, it is a concept is nothing but a mirror. Mirror in the sense, whatever the data it is going to write, it is going to write the data in both the hard disk. Okay, so the available capacity on the RAID 0 by using two hard disks, I'm going to get 100 GB logical size. Mirror, by using 200 GBs, I'm going to configure RAID 0 by using RAID controller. Okay, I'm going to get a logical drive. Here you should understand what is a logical disk. What is a physical disk? Physical disk is nothing but the physical hard disk which we connected to server. Whereas a logical disk is a virtual disk. By using background, by using two physical disks, we are going to create a logical disk. Okay? That we call it as a RAID 0 concept.
Okay.
Generally, RAID 1, the same 100 GB, 200 GB. What it is going to do is going to expand the disk. It is going to expand the disk. What is this RAID concept? This, by using 200 GB disk, I'm going to get 200 GB logical disk size. Okay. But what is here difference between RAID 0 and RAID 1? In RAID 0, if one hard disk is failed, I can sustain my data, I can survive my server without any downtime. Okay, there won't be any data loss. One hard disk is failed means I can replace that hard disk with a good one. Okay, coming to the RAID 1, During some servers, they are going to use more space required. That doesn't matter. Even the disk is failed or disk is not available, doesn't matter. They need a more space. So that they go with a RAID 1 concept. Okay. Here in this RAID concepts also, the configuration major important parameter what we need to understand here, not only logical size availability, at the same time, read and write access per a given second. For example, in RAID 0 mirror, it is going to write the data both the hard disk at the same time. That in the sense, read and write access half of the size it is going to reduce. Right? Okay. So, RAID 1 is in the sense, it is going to give 100% read and write access. Okay? RAID 5 configuration minimum requires 3 hard disks. Minimum 3 hard disk, right? 0 for 8.5 concept is stripe set where parity with stripe set the characters. You go to the Google and check what is the RAID configurations are available. Don't go in deep, just overview what is RAID concepts are available, what type of RAID configurations are available. Just remember the RAID controller will be there in a server administration. It is a basic requirement to understand how the server configuration. Without understanding a RAID concept in a server, you are not going to call as a server administration. Okay, these are the basic requirements. While you, if you are working on a physical server, you should understand what is storage, what is CPU, what is memory, what is storage, what is network. These 5 components are very critical, important for your server administration. Okay, so coming to the RAID 5, parity with stripe set. Okay, so go to search the websites, basic understand, read out and write somewhere what is the RAID configurations are available, what is RAID 0, we call it as a mirror. What is RAID 1? We call it as a spanned volume. What is RAID 5? Parity with stripe set. All of this, what we are going to achieve at the end? We are going to achieve redundancy. If one physical component is failed, how to retrieve the data? That is important concept here. Okay? So, under RAID 5, it is going to output, what is the output? The concept is N minus 1. Logical RAID. So, in the sense, what is the total 300 GB, okay? Total 3 disks are available. 2, 3 minus 1. What is each size of the hard disk? 100 GB. One hard disk size is going for stripe set. Okay, so 200 GB is the output. Logical drive, we are going to get the size. Okay. Clear?
Yeah.
No doubt. So go through this basic storage concept. How the storage is going to connect? What you need to understand. First concept is how the server storage is going to connect to the server directly, direct attached storage. Okay, direct attached storage in the sense, whatever the hard disk it is connected, whatever the storage it is connected to the server, and by using which control it is connected to the server. Is it a SKC hard disk? Is it a different type of controller, flash disk or SD card? We need to identify. Okay, generally most of the servers by default comes with two hard disks by default. Even Blink server or a React server or a Tower server by default. According to your configuration requirement, olden days, the Tower servers models are more popular, wherein maybe 6 bays, 7 bays, 10 bays will be there, wherein we can connect number of hard disk in that server. We can connect a RAID controller by using RAID controller. Two hard disk we are going to configure as a RAID 0. Remaining disk we are going to configure by using RAID 5. Okay, so like that they are going to configure. For example, database server. Database server is a major example as a database server. In database server, the OS partition requires some space. So they'll go with RAID 0 for OS partition. Okay. For data, important data, it requires a high speed data transfer rate. So they'll go with RAID 5 configuration. Some temp data will be there. Temp data, log files, and all those things. Those log files and temp data may not required. For that, they need a maximum space, so they go with RAID 1. Even hard disk fail also doesn't matter for that particular partition. Okay, like that they are going to configure in olden days. Okay, so coming back to this, what type of controller it is going to use? Okay, what type of hard disk it is connected? What type of controller, RAID controller? Generally, most of the controllers smart array. Smart array controller. Well, during the power on screen, post screen, you can identify what type of controller it is. Okay, you can go with that configuration. We'll configure this smart controller, RAID controller. What is the hard disk configuration? We'll see in the configuration utility. Okay, while configuring the server. Okay, what type of controller is available on the server? All this comes under direct attached storage. Okay.
Yeah.
RAID concept. So the next one is NAS, network attached storage. Okay, network attached storage in the sense we have a storage devices, we have a limited capacity on the server, only 2 bays are available. Okay, but as the server requires some more storage, not only that. For example, centralized storage purpose, there are multiple servers. Every user is going to store some data. If some data loss in a single server, some server loss or something happens to the server, I should share the data in a centralized location so that it is available for all users at any given point of time. So then the concept comes in network storage, network attached storage, NAS, okay? There are multiple devices are available in the market. How to configure NAS? Okay, what is the requirements to access the network attached storage? Okay,
yeah,
you can Google it. Okay, but are you able to use NAS storage for booting purpose? Can we boot the server with NAS storage? I can say that no. Okay, because server operating system, installation of operating system should be done locally, which connected directly to the server so that it can access the boot partition and it is going to load the operating system. Okay, next one is SAN storage, SAN storage area network. In a server administration, SAN and NAS, very frequently you are going to come across. So we should understand basic concepts of what is NAS, what is SAN. Okay. This SAN and NAS are very popular, very much required in a virtualization world. Okay. While we discuss about virtualization, the SAN storage and NAS storage plays an important role under storage concepts. Without understanding this, both the concepts, there is no virtualization. Because In virtualization, we are going to work number of servers. So number of servers means each server requires some storage. So with that storage, I cannot maintain a local hard disk. So we need a centralized storage wherein I can save the data in a centralized location to access for all the systems. Okay, there is no single point of failure. Even in RAID concept, it is a direct data storage. It is a kind of concept single point of failure. For example, even you can configure RAID controller. If hard disk is failed, that is okay. We can get the data. That's not a problem. One hard disk fail can tolerate. In redundancy concept, one hard disk failure can tolerate the failure capacity. For example, the server itself is down, some processor problem, motherboard problem. My data is there on this server, particular server. How to access the data? There is no visibility. The entire server is down, application is down. Even user data, maybe important files will be there on the server. I cannot access without powering on the server. Okay, so that in the scenario, in that particular scenario, we have to think about these two concepts: network data storage and storage area network, wherein the data is securely copied and available for users to avoid single point of failure. Okay, centralized location, the store data is available for any purpose, any server, okay, any device. So centralized storage concept comes in for NAS and SAN. Okay, clear?
Yeah.
Any doubt on the storage?
In hard disk, you have mentioned that size, I/O, and read, write, and latency. These are the things which are important. So here, what is I/O and what is latency?
Yeah, latency in the sense I/O. Basically, I/O operations is nothing but input-output. Input-output in the sense how much data is going to read and how much data it is going to write. That even bus, whatever the controller we are going to use, for example, SCSI controller, IDE controller, the I/O is nothing but how many input-output actions per given second. We can consider as a read and write also. How much data throughput? Throughput in the sense that number of, for example, if you consider SD card, if you saw while copying the data, you can see the performance of that writing the data. It is going to show as a 20 MB per second, 30 MB per second. That transfer rate, we can call it as I/O operations. What is the read and write happening on this disk? That we call it as I/O operations. What is the throughput? What is the rate of data it is writing? What is the data rate of read and happening? Okay, we can consider. Whereas in latency is nothing but how much time. For example, if a given data is taking more time, for example, I'm copying a 100 GB data. Some, because of high speed capacity, that 100 GB data will copy to that particular location within 5 seconds. Okay, but the same 100 GB data, it may take 10 minutes or 15 minutes. The latency is nothing but the duration it is going to take to read and write. Okay, given a data, it is going to write the in hard disk or read from hard disk. The latency matters how much time it is going to consider consuming to read or write. That is latency. If high latency is there, definitely server performance is going to impact. CPU is there, high CPU is there, memory is there, everything is there. CPU sends an instruction, memory is going to execute buffer, but the data has to copy to that buffer location to execute that instruction. If the data is not responding in a particular manner, then latency, because of latency, even memory is ready, processor is ready to perform the actions, but data is not ready. then automatically the server performance is going to impact. So that's where the concept latency comes in. Okay, we need to make sure the disk latency is not high. If it is, latency is very low. If server performance is suffering some for server performance, we need to identify, is this performance is related to processor? Is this performance related to memory? Is this performance related to disk? Is this performance related to network? If you go to Windows 10 desktop operating system, if you go to desktop or task manager, you can see under performance, the utilization graphs available. What is CPU performance? What is memory performance? What is the disk performance? All those things. Okay. Any other things?
Any other talk? Yeah, yeah. This RAID controller is there, no? RAID
yeah.
controller. So these yeah. hard disks are directly attached to the RAID controller, or the hard disks are directly connected to the motherboard?
Okay. RAID controller is nothing but a one PCI card. You know the PCI card, the network card, similar to network card. Let me go through. This is a RAID controller. How it looks like? It's just like a network adapter. It's just an add-on card to the server.
Yes.
Wherein it is going to sit in the PCI slot or some other available slot on the motherboard. Okay. This controller, generally, without RAID controller also, we have a controllers on the motherboard. Apart from the socket, apart from the memory modules, there is one more module wherein we can connect a SCSI controller. Generally, in desktop motherboard, how your hard disk is going to connect, the one cable connector will be there.
Yes.
One end of the cable connects to hard disk, other end is connected to motherboard. Okay, that we call it as ID controller. Earlier concept of servers, the hard disk are going to connect SCSI controller. SCSI controller, general IDE controller supports only two devices per controller. Whereas in SCSI controller, it can support 15 devices. The SCSI cable will be there. The cable comes with different connectors. One end is connected to the motherboard. The other ends, we can connect to different hard disks. So here, in this RAID controller concept, this controller have an SCSI adapter, SCSI connector. So that cable is going to connect to this SCSI adapter, the RAID controller, instead of connecting that controller to the and the motherboard.
Yeah.
Very clear?
Yeah, yeah, right.
The same hard disks are available. Okay, the same number of hard disks that are connected to SCSI controller. The other end, instead of connecting to motherboard, it is going to connect to this RAID controller.
Okay.
That SCSI adapter kind of concept will be there. Generally, latest servers, what is blade servers, rack servers, there is no adapter. This RAID controller is inbuilt on the motherboard. There is a separate bay will be there on the particular server. So the RAID is nothing but just like a box, which is directly attached to back end. It is connected to the motherboard. Only thing is that we have an option in RAID controller, the server, we can attach, remove the disk, attach the disk. There will be a lever. Even you have a server, right? We can see that. There is a box, RAID controller box, wherein we just insert the hard disk, backside it automatically connects to that RAID controller, and RAID controller is going to connect back end connected to the motherboard. Clear?
Yeah, yeah. And one more thing, this when it comes to the hard disks, there are some types of hard disks are there, no? That SATA hard disk and SAS hard disks. SAS.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this SAS comes under which type of attached to the storage? So attached to the motherboard.
See, where the SCSI controller is available? SCSI controller is available on the motherboard.
Small board, yes.
Or else it is available on a RAID controller. Okay, so whatever the type of connector you are going to use, the server is going to as a part of specification. Like the server supports only SCSI hard disk. That in the sense that RAID controller is supports only SCSI hard disk, and the motherboard is supports only SCSI hard disk. If the RAID controller comes with a different controllers, serial attached storage, okay, SATA or SAS, okay, whatever it may be, what type of controller it is available on that particular motherboard or the RAID controller, that matters. What type of hard disk you need to choose, that controller specification provides clear information. Okay, I cannot insert SATA disk in a SCSI controller bay, okay, because the connector is totally different. Okay, whatever the parameters, whatever the specifications for this RAID controller is available, we need to choose that respective hard disk only. Variable controller, there is a specification. A SCSI controller provides, this is a data transfer rate. Okay. So